Good morning, everybody. I'm Steve Pulaski, back and better than ever for Sleepless with Steve on this beautiful Wednesday morning, the show that brings you great film talk punctuated with a little bit of rock music for good measure. Special show tonight, changing it up, throwing a little bit of a curveball tonight. Dominic Guanzon, unfortunately, is not present, but Lord knows I will drag him back into the realm of film talk sooner or later. But I'm joined by somebody very special, amiable, inimitable in her own way, DJ Gia Maria. How are you doing?
Doing pretty good, DJ Steve. How's it hanging?
Not too bad. You can just call me Steve. You don't have to drop the DJ. I'm not that important.
Oh,
I'm not
sure.
That important. Like somebody else. I'm not that important. You know?
Sure.
Very, very nice to see you, though. Very nice to have you on the show. You requested to come on the show. You know what I mean? And I thought, if I can get on, anybody can get on. You know what I mean?
Sure. Definitely.
I dearly appreciate it. Now, before I expound upon everything, because we got a lot of details to cover today. I actually had a hard time narrowing down the kind of talking points for tonight. You know what I mean? For each 3 hours, I had a hard time. There's a lot of stuff, even for coming out this week, a lot of news. You got one of the most, what's destined to be one of the biggest financial failures in film history this week in King Arthur, Legend of the Sword.
Yeah.
So I will be expounding upon that probably about 2 o'clock, during the 2 o'clock hour. But before I start talking about Snatch, the new Amy Schumer film, and the Wall, the new John Cena, Aaron Taylor Johnson film, I have to ask you, so your background in film, what do you like about film, some of the films you like? I'd like to hear from you more than me.
Films. Well, definitely like to go back into the 80s, 90s, diving in. Usually I reside to Netflix, of course, so some of my favorites at the top of my head have to be American Beauty, Ferris Bueller's Day Off, Breakfast Club, and Adventures of Babysitting.
Oh, so, there you go.
Yeah.
I love American Beauty, too. I mean, I love all the films that you just mentioned in a unique way.
Oh, yeah.
But I especially like American Beauty a lot.
I mean, you can't go wrong with Kevin Spacey.
Absolutely. There's another good movie you should see with him, too. It's called, it's a low-key one. Not a lot of people speak of this one. It's called Swimming with Sharks.
I think I've heard of that
and
one.
And it's him and Frank Whaley, who's one of my favorite actors. Frank Whaley, he's another one. He doesn't do a whole lot, but when he does some movies, it's like an event. That's a good one, too, where Kevin Spacey plays like this high-level corporate executive who like bosses around Frank Whaley. You know what I mean? So it's a very good dynamic too. And I've always said with Kevin Spacey, you know why I think his movies work a lot, and I think he works. Granted, I haven't watched House of Cards. I have not watched that show. But you know why I think he works well as an actor is
why
because
is
his philosophy is very unique. He says, "You don't read about me in the tabloids. My private life is very much private." He said, "You don't hear about my personal life." He said, "That way, I'm not always in the news. I'm not always doing interviews. That way, when I play a character, you can believe I'm a character."
Right.
Because you don't know about me. Like, I like a few Brad Pitt movies, but it's hard for me to get out of, like, the fact that I'm watching Brad Pitt.
Because he's so publicized. Like, I don't really hear about Kevin Spacey a lot either now that I come to think of it. Like, he's just so, very low profile, but great actor just all around.
Yeah. I was going to say, and I mean, you like Ferris Bueller's Day Off. You seem to like the kind of John Hughes films as well. I could tell you've probably been influenced a lot by him, as I was. Those were some of the first films I reviewed. You've seen like 16 Candles, Pretty in Pink.
Molly Ringwald.
Molly Ringwald, indeed. I mean, you do like those. You do like a lot of Hughes movies. I was going to say, Hughes wrote a lot, and he wrote a lot of stuff like in the 80s and 90s. He didn't write too much in the 2000s, and he died about, I think, 8 years ago he died.
Okay.
And the interesting thing is that like the movies that he wrote recently, I don't know if you ever heard of the movie Made in Manhattan. I don't know if you ever heard of the movie Drillbit Taylor with Owen Wilson.
I haven't heard of that one.
You've heard of Made in Manhattan?
Yes.
He wrote that.
Yeah.
He wrote that. I mean, he's not credited. He usually went under a fake name or a surname when he was writing later in his life.
Right.
But he went under, like, a fake name. He didn't go by John Hughes in his later life. But he if he didn't write movies, he wrote the stories, or he conceptualized the stories. And, I mean, Breakfast Club's a classic.
Oh, you can't go wrong with Breakfast Club.
You know, that was a good... And that one, too, people laugh. I think people laugh when I say this, too. But I've said before, because I've seen that movie, I think I've seen it, like, 3 or 4 times... I know, right? The first time I watched it, it really felt like in some way I lived it. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like you were there. You know, like you were there for Saturday detention with a group of misfits. You know what I mean?
Got to bring in that different group of people. Everybody's got their own profile. So it really just shows like different things you can kind of apply to the real world. Like it's very... I mean, even though it's a fiction movie, I think you could definitely apply it to the real world and what actually goes on with high school kids and growing up and just all that different
Absolutely.
stuff.
Absolutely. I think it ages like fine wine. You know what I mean? I think it ages so well. I think even with, you know, the advent, you know, with technology and communication evolving or devolving.
It was so different back then. This was the 80s we were talking about.
But of course. And I mean, like, even with the way that, like I was saying, like, communication's evolving and maybe debatably in some ways devolving, The Breakfast Club still remains, you know what I mean? It
definitely
still remains
relevant.
You know, it's not like a movie that ages, or like you watch some of these older 80s
films. Yeah, and then
films.
You go back and you're like, whoa.
Like, I watch a lot of like two of my favorite 80s actors, I don't know if you've ever seen anything by them, but are Corey Haim and Corey Feldman. I like those two a lot. They did a movie called License to Drive, which is very good.
Oh, I have seen that one.
That's them.
Oh,
that's them.
That's such a good movie.
I like them a lot. I like License to Drive a lot because James Avery's in it, Uncle Phil, who plays the driving instructor too. That's a fun one. And that's like a movie too that like nobody, that's the kind of thing that really doesn't get made anymore.
Thanks to Netflix. I think that I watched
it is on
that
Netflix.
Like a couple years ago.
It is on
Netflix. I was like 15 or 16 when I first saw it. It's a good movie though.
And like that's another movie that like really doesn't, I say it doesn't get made a lot because, you know, of course there's teen movies. There's always going to be teen movies. They're still a modern day. But there's a movie about like a big aspect of growing up that you don't really see in movies a lot. Driver's license. You know what I mean? I don't know about you. I was petrified of driving when I was younger. I really was. And I mean, that's a big moment in adulthood.
Yeah.
Or like becoming an adult and, you know.
Just getting to do all these things growing up.
Exactly. And once you get the privilege to drive, like I've been driving now for about 3 years, you don't remember not being able to drive.
Right.
You couldn't believe that you had to ask for rides or get from your parents.
Yeah, ask for a ride. You were having a permit. You're kind of like, oh my goodness.
And that film was also the first performance by Heather Graham as well, by the actress Heather Graham. I think that was her first film in 1985. I think it was 85 or 86.
Off my head right now.
85, 86. I'm glad you've seen it though, because Corey Haim and Corey Feldman, I love those two.
Oh, yeah.
I was gonna say Corey Haim passed away about 7 years ago, but I mean it was they were great together. I think they did 8 movies together. I think there was 8.
Yeah, something around.
But I know you didn't get a chance to see any of the new releases, and you're probably smarter for having not, because there wasn't a lot out this week that was worth your time and money too. Even the one that I kind of liked this week that was dead on arrival, the movie The Wall with Aaron Taylor Johnson and John Cena. And I think the most disappointing thing about that film is I still don't know whether or not John Cena can act. I still don't know, because he's not in it enough. You know what I mean? And he's not really written very much in the film.
No, definitely not. I feel like John Cena resides more to wrestling than
that's
anything.
What it is. Or these cameo appearances in movies like Sisters and Trainwreck
and
stuff.
Trainwreck, which was Amy Schumer's recent movie. I think that was 2015?
15, yes, indeed. I was going to say, before I get into Snatch, because I'm excited to have you on here. I'm excited to have a different voice, different perspective. I know you didn't see Snatched. You did see some or all of Trainwreck.
Yeah.
So I was going to say, what are your thoughts on Amy Schumer? What are your thoughts on like Trainwreck and stuff like that? What do you make of Schumer's rise in popularity?
You know, I just, like, the movie was pretty good in my opinion. A lot of people that I watched the movie with thought it was quote-unquote dumb or quote-unquote sleazy. So I think personally it was entertaining. I'm all for a raunchy rom-com. I think Amy Schumer, personally, I'm not a big fan of her. I just think, do you know who Rebel Wilson is?
Indeed, I do. I like her a lot.
I like her a lot, and I feel like Amy Schumer is just another version of her. So for me, it was just kind of like dry comedy with Amy Schumer. I mean, she was trying. It was her character. You had to be a raunchy 20-something-year-old writing for a journal company, I think it was.
Yeah.
I'm trying to think back.
It's been a while for me. I saw it in the theater.
Yeah. John Cena was in that. I know he was one of the guys that Amy Schumer slept with. So
Bill Hader's in it. LeBron James is in it.
A lot of interesting characters. A lot of interesting cameos for sure in that movie. I think the plot overall was really good. Something that could definitely be applied to real life just in the young 20s and having a big responsibility with the job and just trying to figure out things in your life growing up. And I personally think that Trainwreck was pretty good. I give it probably around 3.5 out of 5 stars.
There you go.
Give Amy Schumer about 2 out of 5 stars.
Oh, well, what are you not fond of about her? Do you think she's too one note? Do you think that she's
definitely
like
one note. Same kind of humor. I think she just, like, Rebel Wilson mixed things up, but she's also clever and on the spot. Like, throughout Pitch Perfect, and even in Bridesmaids, which was 2011, just Rebel Wilson kind of had a different kind of humor. Like, her clapbacks were interesting. Her style of characters she's had just were very, I mean, they weren't really similar, but they all had the same kind of humor, but she mixed things up for each character. Like, you have her as the roommate in Bridesmaids for Kristen Wiig's character, and then in Pitch Perfect she was Fat Amy, which was the notorious singer who kind of delivered all the clever clapbacks. She was kind of the outcast of the group. So I think having her as the roommate in Bridesmaids and then Fat Amy in the Pitch Perfect series was definitely a nice twist for her.
And did you see How to Be Single? Did you see How to Be Single
with
Dakota
haven't.
Johnson? You know that one?
I do know that one.
That came out about a year ago, I believe, and that one had her in it, too. I wasn't a huge fan of the movie, but even I still think Rebel Wilson, aside from Pitch Perfect, is kind of waiting for her good showcase. Like, she was in another movie, too, that, like, nobody watched. It was called Small Apartments.
She was
in that one, and that was really odd. That was a very strange film, very, like ugly movie. But, I mean, I think Rebel Wilson's in many ways, she's waiting to be. She reminds me a lot of Kate McKinnon in the sense that, because I love Kate McKinnon. I think Kate McKinnon's hilarious. The thing is, she reminds me a lot of Kate McKinnon because she's always like the secondary character in movies.
Yeah.
And like, she's oftentimes funnier than the primary characters in the movie. But like, no studio exec saying, put her in a starring role. Like, same with Kate McKinnon. Kate McKinnon is, and you see it now after Ghostbusters, because now she's going to be in that movie Rough Night. She was in Masterminds as well. She's going to get sidelined. She's going to keep having to play, like, backup to the starters, you know what I mean, to the headliners
definitely.
And stuff. But Snatch came out this weekend, the new Amy Schumer Goldie Hawn comedy. I don't know if you know about Goldie Hawn. This is her first movie in 15 years.
Yeah.
The last movie she did was with Susan Sarandon called The Banger Sisters back in 2002.
Wow.
Goldie Hawn's a treasure. She really is. I mean, the only thing is that I really can't figure out is why she decided to come out of retirement for Snatched.
Yeah, really.
Like, I can't figure that out.
How from under, really?
And you know that she's been offered scripts in 15 years. You know that she's read scripts. You know that she's been pitched ideas. And all of a sudden, what gets her off her couch is Snatched with Amy Schumer. I don't get it. I don't understand it. But the movie Snatched, it revolves around a mother. It's perfect for Mother's Day. Mother's Day was this weekend. It revolves around a mother and daughter. The Amy Schumer's character's recently dumped and loses her job. It's funny. The first 10 minutes is like a remake of Trainwreck.
Okay.
Like, she gets dumped, she loses her job, and her boyfriend breaks up with her.
Maybe it was a secret prequel or sequel.
You know, I'm
thinking that.
I thought I was watching a remake within the first 10 minutes. But the film is kind of then after she loses her job and gets dumped and everything, she goes on this retreat to Ecuador. Which she planned to go on with her mother. She planned to go on with her boyfriend. She goes with her mother.
And then the boyfriend breaks up with her.
Yes, the boyfriend breaks up with her. She goes with her mother. They go to Ecuador or whatever. They wind up getting kidnapped. They wind up getting kidnapped and such. And then they wind up going to they wind up getting stuck in Colombia. So the whole plot kind of revolves around them trying to get back. And then in addition to Ike Barinholtz, I think his name is. He plays the Amy Schumer's brother in the film, who's trying to get them back to safety back in America. And the thing is, this movie is kind of like a half-hearted parody of Taken. Like a half-hearted parody in a way. And overall, I don't think it works too well. I really didn't think it was too compelling. I think that the problem with this movie is you get moments of like tenderness.
Yeah,
you get
of course.
Moments of raunchiness. And then you get moments of violence where people are getting like archery. You're getting moments of like people getting shot in the Adam's apple with a sword. And stuff, and like with a bow and arrow. And I don't think it works. I don't think it meshes well. I think it's too tonally inconsistent in a lot of respects. You know, I mean, Amy Schumer is okay in this, but Amy Schumer is at her, like, same with Melissa McCarthy in a way. She's at her worst when she's not restricted in a way, when she's
definitely.
Not given a direction and she can kind of go off on her own. Some you know, comedians can do that. Chris Farley was good at doing that. Amy Poehler and Tina Fey, they're great when you give them a thin idea. They can carry that and they can run with it. Greta Gerwig, who not a lot of people know, is wonderful. But Amy Schumer, the problem with her is that if you give her too little, she will wind up doing too much.
Yeah,
and,
definitely.
And, like Melissa McCarthy, too, in her movies. I don't know if you saw, wound up seeing Spy, Tammy, Identity Thief, any of those films
Identity
you saw.
Thief.
Yes. The problem with her is that when you give her a movie, a thin premise, and then you give her an R rating, she'll swear for an hour and 40 minutes.
Basically,
that's
yeah.
about it. Where is it like, that's why I liked Ghostbusters more than the average consumer, was that Ghostbusters, it was a PG-13 rating.
Yeah.
Melissa McCarthy, and she had to compete for the kind of like the limelight with three other actresses. So she wasn't getting the kind of, you know, implicit, ubiquitous exposure that she would get normally in her own starring vehicle. Where Amy Schumer really, really kind of runs herself thin in this movie. She's kind of just resorted to what she is at her most basic, which I said was like obnoxious, rowdy, and just sort of uncontrollable. Like Trainwreck, she had a good balance. Like anytime that she was starting to veer towards that, I'd argue, she was kind of rebounded by either Bill Hader or LeBron James or somebody saving her. I don't know if you'd agree with that, but there was always some sort of like out for her. Where this movie, there's too much of her doing too little of anything really interesting.